Fair warning, all this is being recorded, yes. And good morning, welcome, I'm Grant Hunter, I'm the, I guess, the host today for our final week of exploring Ted Lasso with our Reverend Doodle Harris today. So this is the fourth week, I said. If you missed any previous sessions, I'm told that they are up on YouTube, on the First Presbyterian YouTube page, if you're interested in looking back. So again, thanks for joining us. Doodle has already warned us this may last an hour, may not last an hour, but we'll have fun. We'll have some good conversation. And with that, I'll turn it over to her.
Thanks.
I guess we can clap. I don't know.
Only sure.
I should say, let me also be transparent that my wife is on her way with my notes for this class. So I'm going to thank it for a few minutes before. Look, I got a lot of things together today. Right? She's not all of things. But anyway, today is we're going to explore what happened to Nate, or as I titled the class, where Nate went wrong. Of all the classes that we've done so far, I feel like I have had answers to a lot of the questions and the things we've explored. And today I feel the least like I have the answers. So I'm looking forward to your insights and participation and helping us figure out together why what happened today happened today. But in case you haven't seen the show yet, I decided I'd bring us all up to date first. So first of all, in the very first season, we have Ted Lasso walking onto the pitch. It's his first time on the soccer pitch in England, in Richmond, and he sees Nate, and he asks Nate his name, and he compliments him on his sports mix. Nate is, does it ever give what his official title is? He's like the team manager. He's in charge of washing the uniforms and getting out the Gatorade and locking and unlocking the field every day. So Lasso introduces himself to it. Nathan introduces himself to Lasso. Ted Lasso immediately shortens his name to Nate from Nathan. Oh, good, my notes. Thank you so much. And then at the end of the first episode, Nate is surprised that Ted Lasso remembers his name. Do you remember that awkward moment from the first episode? Oh, you remember my name. So that's how it starts. And also at the end of the first episode, Nate gives Beard, Coach Beard, and Lasso a ride home. And that's that funny scene where Beard's in the back seat with his luggage like pressed up against his face, and he's leaning back, and there's barely room in this tiny car for the three of them and their luggage. But that's our introduction to Nate. Sort of this character who does his job, who is a helper, but doesn't expect any attention or doesn't expect anyone to notice him. We've all got Nates in our life, I presume. In the second episode, for the first time, it'll happen two or three times. So Coach Lasso has asked Nate to make a suggestion box for the locker room. And we find out that Nate has made the suggestion box with his niece. And so it looks like a frog, and it's got a tongue hanging out, and it's adorable googly eye. I'm such a sucker for googly eyes. And so the team is putting suggestions in the suggestion box, and Jamie Tart, the jerk face in season one, puts gum in there, and there's a whole exchange there. But that's the beginning of us learning that Jamie and members of the team pick on Nate regularly and belittle him, call him names, move his stuff around. And so that's our second introduction to how the team treats Nate. When Lasso in the third episode, and remember, Ted Lasso's never played soccer before. He doesn't even know what offsides means. When he's asking for new ideas to help Richmond win, it is Nate who gives him a suggestion. And then Lasso asks him to repeat himself, and that's where we get this iconic line from the show. Sorry, Nate, I had a real tricky time hearing people who don't believe in themselves. That line meant so much to my family, we now have a mug in our kitchen collection with that very line on it. So it's the first time that Lasso encourages Nate to speak up, to be someone a little different, to live into his identity as a member of this team. Well, last week we talked about the community and how that's what Lasso was trying to build in his very unconventional ways. And this is what he's doing with Nate. He's trying to get Nate to join the team or to have that attitude. It reminded me of this quote. This is a really famous self-help book back in the 90s. Did we all read this book in the 90s?
Yes, we did.
I can't remember what it's called.
I was just born in the 90s, so.
But this is the most quoted part of that book that none of us remember the name of. Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that frightens us most. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, fabulous? But actually, who are you not to be? You are a divine child. Your playing small does not serve the world. There is nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people don't feel insecure around you. We are all meant to shine as children do. We were born to make manifest the light that is within us. It is not just in some of us, but it is in everyone. As we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. And so this is where I am with Nate. Is he afraid of the beginning to let his light shine? Matt says, yes, I like it when people agree with me. Are you seeing similarities between this encouragement and where we start with the character of Nate?
Seemingly so, yes.
Do you want to elaborate on that, Grant? Or?
Well, I've never watched the show, but yeah, I mean, from what you describe, he's someone who is has ideas, has good thoughts, but maybe a bit timid.
Yeah. We start with Nate, I believe, living in fear. He never says, I'm afraid, but at his actions and the way that he interacts sort of is this fear to be who I'm supposed to be. Yes, Sherry.
And he keeps doing what he thinks he can do best. He's uncertain about anything else because he's only been given any support for handing out Gatorade.
Mm-hmm. He should have. That's right. So that's where we start with Nate.
Can you draw comparisons to him to like Adam Sandler in the Waterboy role, perhaps? Or is that a bit of a stretch?
I haven't seen that.
He's not. Adam Sandler plays like he's dumb. Mm-hmm. And Nate's not dumb.
He's just timid
and unsure of himself. And he's trying to figure out what's his place on this team or organization.
Gotcha. Mm-hmm. So it's not quite the same.
Mm-hmm. He's never really been given a chance. So yeah. Nobody's ever treated him like he is of value.
Okay, understood. Thanks for that clarification.
So when Lasso listens to his idea in season 3, this is his response. I have so many new feelings. So Nate is trying to live into this idea that at 20 whatever, he's finally been heard. After that, the players are still picking on Nate. Roy is so angry, he beats them up. Nate sees this, and thus we have the conflict between Jamie and Roy we talked about a couple of weeks ago in the first season. Roy doesn't like that the players are picking on Nate. Jamie's enabling them to do so. So that's where we have that tension, is around this character who has no self-esteem and doesn't know who he is, has created one of the biggest controversies in the first half of the first season by his presence and existence. So we move on to the fundraiser. Ted needs a date. Nate's not invited. The big team fundraiser, Nate wasn't invited. And Ted brings Nate as his plus one. If you remember that scene where Ted goes to pick him up and Nate comes down in this suit that doesn't fit him at all. And Ted says, well, I'm going to go buy you a new suit. And so then Ted buys him a new suit. In episode 5 of season 1, we learned that Nate's father is a cartographer because Nate knows how many the random distances it is between cities around the world. I tried to make that fit today's conversation and I couldn't, but that's your challenge. And then Lasso fusses at Jamie during practice and Nate is happy about that. And Lasso says, oh no, this is a no Schadenfreude zone. Which is interesting because that's the first time that Nate displays some feelings that aren't, you know, wimpy and self-deprecating. Which then I had to look up Schadenfreude. But I want to keep this in front of us because this idea of damage or harm joy from damage, joy from harm, that's what I wonder if we don't watch in Nate's art throughout season 1 or 2. if his joy somehow comes from damage and not from a better place. Does that make sense? If it doesn't, I'm going to keep going. So as we continue to follow Nate's story, this is the other thing that came to me from Romans 12. So Nate's laughing that Jamie gets made fun of or picked on in practice. And then we have this from Romans. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. And for the first time, Nate's not doing that. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. I love that. That's what I think when I drive down the interstate and somebody cuts me off. Leave room for the, okay, I'll do that. For it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their head. Do not overcome, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. So, Lasso, for me, embodies this all throughout the show. Do you all see this other places in the show where Lasso is leaving room for the wrath of God, but he himself is not displaying it? Sure. And the way that he deals with his wife, now ex-wife, and the way that he deals with the boss, Rebecca, and forgives her for being such a jerk face to him. Yeah. That's the word we use at our house, is jerk face. The way that he deals with Jamie's rudeness. Lasso was constantly, as my mother would say, taking the high road. But encourages Nate to do the same. I want to know if you have any thoughts about this part. When you are being kind and good to others who are not, you heap burning coals on their heads. Oh my God, to you? Mm-hmm. I really want a good sermon on this passage. I've never heard it, but I would really like to hear how do you reconcile that with your own faith? And yet it's what Lasso does and what Lasso encourages Nate to do, to give space for you be kind and let God do the work. So thoughts? Nobody's going to take on the heat burning coals on you. I don't have a good explanation either. I hold this dear to my heart at times that I need it.
I think that's really hard. Everything that pastor says is really hard, because when you are being mistreated and you take the high road, there is some joy in seeing that justice came back around sometimes, you know, and It's hard to take that road.
Yeah. And the pain of waiting for God to do it, so doing it yourself.
Yeah. Well, and often the waiting, we don't often see what happens. We don't often see the coals being heaped on somebody's head, you know, because time has passed or we've put some distance between us and that person or that situation. And so we don't always get to see that full circle happen.
And then you have to ask yourself, is that in the character of God to do that? I don't know that many of us are worshiping a God that we're like, woo, the heaping gold guy, awesome, yes, I'm in. We're Presbyterians, we don't do that.
Yeah, certainly.
We certainly don't.
That's true. So here's a funny story. So when I was seven, we joined the Presbyterian church in my hometown. And speaking of Presbyterians being in their ways, they brought in my mom and my dad, and I was there, and my brother was still an infant in arms. And but we had to meet before the session. They were like, yay, you're members now. And apparently, I don't remember this, but in front of that whole session, my seven-year-old question was, do we get our assigned seats now? That's what I thought Presbyterians, like you did in school, you had assigned seats. That's what Presbyterians are.
It's not far
off. Like, that was my perception as a little kid. Anyway, so we keep going. Episode 6 of the season 1 is what I call the exorcism episode. It's where they're trying, what is it? There's a room in the locker house that no one wants to go in because it's cursed, they believe. And so Lasso develops this elaborate ritual to get rid of the curse. And other players are throwing in really meaningful things into this fire, or the fire that's about to be lit, in a way of saying, I am letting go of those things from my past that hold me back. And so some of the players let go of a blanket their grandfather gave them. Some let go of a picture of the world championship team with their heroes in it. So they're throwing in these meaningful things, and Nate throws in a pair of sunglasses that a girl once said she liked. And that, for me, is such a witness to his lack of self-esteem, that the most valuable object he has is a pair of sunglasses a cute girl once said they liked. So that, perhaps, is how down in the dumps Nate is. In episode 7, he gets trapped under the bus on the way to play Manchester because he's rearranging luggage. He doesn't like the way the players have all thrown in their luggage. He goes under, rearrange it, and while he's down there, the bus driver shuts the bottom of the bus. They start off, Lasso realizes Nate's missing and goes after him and finds him under the bus. And then, so once again, there's also this theme of Lasso being Nate's sort of savior figure, the one who continues to rescue him over and over. And then on the bus, Nate won't share this idea he has for how to beat Manchester. Finally, in the hotel they get to, Nate slips a note under Lasso's door with his idea of how to win the game. Lasso, who has just signed his divorce papers, is very angry, opens the door, yells at him, closes the door. But then the next day in the locker room, we see Lasso's apology to Nate, and we also see Nate reading the notes to the team that he has shared with Lasso. So this is Lasso encouraging Nate to own what he has to say. There's some colorful language in this. We all know that, but I thought it would be an interesting scene to watch and talk about. Higgins, she doesn't love Higgins.
Come on, let's go!
Pussy.
What the fuck do you say to your brother? You're more concerned about looking tough than actually being tough. There's a way to be intimidating without being physical. I hope you don't mind saying. Sam.
Oh, no.
You're constantly getting beat on the wings. It's because you're indecisive. You second guess more than a shitty psychic. The only African I know more imprisoned by their own thoughts is goddamn Nelson Mandela. Oh, you think that's funny, do you, Colin? You know, you fancy step over bullshit. Let me ask you this. Do you wax your pubes?
What?
Did I start to dickhead? Do you wax your pubes, yes or no?
No.
Then why are you always trying to play like a Brazilian?
What just happened?
Rojas.
Roast meat. Have you got
to... Right, you're saying that football is life, right?
Football is life.
Yeah, well, then your defence is death. Oh. The only person I've seen lose a man more often is Carrie fucking Bradshaw.
Oh.
Yeah. Right, Roy.
Roy's a player with anger management issues.
Oh. Hey, what are you gonna say? Don't read it. Say it to my face.
The great Roy Kent. You're old now. And slow. Your focus drifts. Your speed and your smiles will never want to make you who you are. It's your anger. That's your superpower. That's what made you one of the best midfielders in the history of this league. And I haven't seen it on the pitch at all this season, Roy. I mean, you used to run like you were angry at the grass. You kick the ball like you've got it fucking your wife, for Christ's sake. But that anger doesn't come out anymore when you play. But it's still in there. And I'm afraid of what it's going to do to you if you just keep it all for yourself.
Okay, what do you think of that scene? What do you see in there that gives us an insight into tonight?
He's gaining confidence.
Slowly.
He's very perceptive.
Mm-hmm.
In an individual way, so he made everything personal.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't like we're doing this or we're doing that.
Over and over, he is one of, if not the best soccer football strategists on the team. Over and over.
Clearly knows his stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Although the others may have poked fun at him or been mean to him or whatever, they have a sense of respect for him because they allow him to stand in front of the room, give eye contact,
mm-hmm.
and they listen. So maybe they weren't even aware that they respected him.
Here's what troubles me about this scene. I agree with everything that's been... Here's what troubles me, though. He's kind of mean. Why does he, as one who has been bullied and someone who has... that others have been mean to, we are going to assume his whole life, certainly in this season, why is he a little bit mean or a lot mean to some of the other players?
That's the language they speak.
I wondered that. I've never been a sports person, so I don't know.
You wonder if that's the only way, you know, it's perceived at this point, if that's the only way he knows or how he understands to communicate and or push people.
Yeah, it's like learned.
Mm-hmm. Learned behavior.
Or it could be he's got a lot of resentment built up against them.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And is it okay? I don't know. My kids come out with these funny phrases and I don't understand where they've come from. And it's because they've been watching. This to me is so boring. I don't know if you have kids who do this. They watch people on YouTube play video games. So they're not playing themselves. They're watching other people play video games. And they start saying the same phrases that they do. And they're not necessarily mean, but man, that's bizarre coming out of a 7-year-old's mouth. I don't know if maybe that conditioning that you all are alluding to is what we hear here. But what troubles me is that Nate begins to get confidence and feel that confidence and feel that respect while not exactly being kind to the other players. Is that just inherent in sports? Is that the way it is? Is that a cause for larger concern?
I think that's within all of us. When we have been put down and harmed by words or actions, it's all internalized and we have to work it through and speak it before we can totally expunge it and move forward.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's fantastic commercial therapy. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I've had a lot of it.
So. I recommend it. Kids come up to me at college sometime and they're like, you're telling me to go, have you? Yes, I have done this. What are you waiting for? And it's free right now, so let's go. Yeah. Something about naming it that helps you claim it.
Yeah. I think he's been bullied for so long, probably his whole life. Now he's responding to that and feeling a little bit of sense of power. Mm-hmm. And not understanding that in order to express my ideas and gain respect, there might be a kinder, gentler, softer way to communicate, which you hope he'll learn from Ted Lasso. But right now, he's just dishing them back a little of their own medicine. And then he sees their response as respect, not anger. Mm-hmm.
It's a dynamic we have to be careful of in the church. And as I've said in other classes, I don't know this church as well as I've known other churches. I will one day. But we have to be careful that the church in this community, that we are encouraging people not to... Whoa, stop! Not to take out some of that anger and bullying here. And I see that the most often, and don't nod if it happens here, just don't let me know. I see it sometimes in committees where someone will be on the session or a committee chair who means well, but doesn't always realize the effect of what they're saying, or doesn't always realize that it doesn't take that type of language in this community to be the body of Christ. Does that make sense? Maybe this isn't here, but... Amanda could also give you multiple examples of that, too.
I think it's also just kind of walking that line of, is he being mean or is he being honest? And is there a way to be honest without being mean? I think that's a lot of times that's, I feel like when bullying is what's happening, a lot of times it's coming from a place of, I'm just going to be brutally honest with you about what I think about you, but I'm going to say it in the worst way I can, as opposed to being honest, but kind of filtering your language a little bit so that it's not an attack.
Yeah. I don't know. I told you, this was the session I have the least answers about. I feel the most uncomfortable talking about.
I wonder what it said on the paper. Do you think it had all those words? Because then Ted Lasso kind of,
I don't know.
Encouraged him to say them, you know, almost fed him to the wolves. Or was it just like bullet, like this guy needs to work on this? You know, I wonder, did he know that's how that was going to go down?
Great question. I don't know. But in the very next episode, Nate is back to sleeping under the bus. He is so afraid he won't wake up in time to go home with the team on the bus. He just sleeps under the bus with the luggage again so that if he misses his wake-up time the next day, he's at least on the bus home.
So we have this moment of courage and bravery, followed by this moment of like, let me literally throw myself under the bus. In the last episode of season one, Nate walks into the locker room and finds someone else doing his job. He's been insecure the whole season that he's going to lose his job, even though we know he has these incredible ideas. And it turns out the team is in waiting like a surprise party to let him know that he's been promoted to coach. Will, who was doing his job, becomes the new water boy team manager type. And they present Nate with his own whistle. Because I guess that's how you know you've made it in soccer world, is you get a whistle. Which, incidentally, I love in season two. So, spoiler alert for season two. Roy also becomes one of the coaches, and Roy refuses to use a whistle. You remember this? So he stands out on the soccer field, and he's like, whistle, whistle. Like, that's how he's trying to get this. It makes me laugh. Anyway. But what to inspire the team in their last game of the season as a new coach, Nate shows them a pregame video of Jamie, who is no longer playing for Richmond, trashing that team. And so that's his way of motivating, is revenge. So this is a piece to me that I'm still kind of trying to, because I want them all to be good guys, right? Good guys with troubled pasts. And at this point, I don't know where to put Nate in that category. So then we skip on to season two. The Diamond Dogs are a club? I don't know what the right word. An organization, a support group that Lasso sort of puts together. And it's Nate, Higgins, Beard, and Lasso himself. Eventually, Roy joins, but not to the very end of the season. But those four, and they have these deep talks about relationships and coaching in the world. And so Nate is invited to join. And Jamie wants to be back on the team. And there's this really, I couldn't find a YouTube clip on it, or I would have shown it, where they're discussing this. And Nate says it would ruin morale to have someone belittling everyone on the team. And then Nate turns around and yells at Will for putting the towels in the wrong place. And then turns back towards the group. So Nate, clearly by season two, is a different person. We are no longer feeling like we are the underdog. We are now feeling like we have the ability and the right to boss others around. Does that? And we don't have any, the only indication we have that something has changed is that now he's a coach. So, the Christmas episode. Do you remember the Christmas, my favorite episode in season two? Nate is only in it at the beginning, where they all come together as a community and they have this Christmas meal together. Nate is missing. I don't know what that says, but I think it's important. Then we have, so I've shared in the past that I follow a lot of these online blogs and ideas about the show. And the answer to where Nate went wrong has one of three answers in all of the blogs that I've read, and they keep coming back up. So here's, I will present to you those three answers, and you decide if you know. The first one is when Nate goes into the restaurant, the Aspen something, Taste of Athens. That's what he does. He goes into the restaurant. I can't believe I just pulled that out of my head. He goes into this restaurant. It's his parents' anniversary. He wants to give them a nice meal. He asks to make a reservation at the window. And Jade, the hostess, says, well, we can't give that to you. We can give you a corner table. And he says, well, I know Roy Kent. He's trying to get, and Jade says, well, if Roy Kent comes in here, he can make a reservation at the window table. But you can't. And so then Nate, after that scene, in the same episode, Nate goes to Keeley and says, can you make me famous? Keeley hears the story and gets Rebecca, the boss, and Keeley start coaching Nathan as to how to be assertive in the restaurant. So they have the scene where they're replaying him walking into the restaurant over and over, and they're encouraging him to be assertive. So this is the first place that they claim that perhaps Nathan went wrong, was where Keeley and Rebecca teach him and make him practice that awful role play that some of us made, some teachers made us do in high school, that they did that with him. And so is that what changed Nate? It's also important to note that Rebecca, in this coaching, encourages him to puff himself up and think of himself as bigger than he really is. And so this is that scene where he is trying, he is finally being assertive. His parents, Jade the hostess.
Shelley, Alfie 3.
Let's see, Shelley.
No, Bang. Sorry, yes, that's correct. That's a lot of names. We're all Shelleys. A gaggle of Shelleys.
Oh, blame it on the old lady, your mother's on.
Stop it, Dwight. Forgive your father, my darling. He's been wanting this Saganaki all week. Jimmy remembers that this before the anniversary. Jade.
Of course. Right this way.
Sorry, if you remember, I requested the window table.
So we don't take reservations for the window table.
Excuse me, one more. Respect. You are Nathan fucking Shelley. Right back. Don't get too quick. Jade, this is a special night for my parents, and the window table is open, so here is what I would love to see happen. You're going to give us that table, and then my family and I are going to order a starter, main course, Lord Pizza, bottle of wine, and you are going to be stunned by how quickly a gaggle of Shelley's can get for a free course meal and get out of there. So what do you say?
Okay.
Well done. Would you like to give me a number as well?
No, that's okay. Sorry, I'm picking.
Oh, me too.
What's a dog?
I'm not a dog.
Thank you. So is that where Nathan goes wrong? By getting the courage, by accepting the coaching and insisting on the table at the restaurant? One answer. And the next episode, Nate gets jealous that Roy makes a call that wins the game. And then, or not wins the game, that gets them a point. Later in the same game, Nate hears Beard and Roy discussing what to call next. He ignores them and yells, "Park the bus," which is a trick play they've all been working on. And at the end of the game, they come up to Roy and ask Roy about the game because he's now coaching, and he gives Nate all the credit for winning the game. And then Nate appears on social media as the Wonder Kid. I want to keep that in front of us because that's the number two thing. Is it because Nate won the game and Nate suddenly appears on social media and he gets a following after winning that game? But again, Roy's giving him the credit the whole time. Nate goes to his parents in the next episode. He has his picture on the front page. He's won. His dad is reading the newspaper with his picture, Nate's picture, on the front page. He asks his dad if he's heard the news and what does he think. And dad's reply is this: humility isn't thinking less of yourself, but thinking of yourself less. Which sounds great. Except that what does that do with that father and son dynamic?
Deplates him.
Yeah. Nate is suddenly invisible in front of his father. Wouldn't that make some of us act out? Wouldn't that send some of us to therapy? That's a book that I'm going to write in the future, are all the father-son relationships in this movie, this TV show. But so then Nate once again goes back to Colin in the same episode and has to be mean to him. You don't inspire, you just You don't move people, you do the job, so just do the job. He's Colin's asking him for advice, and Nate blows him off. Later, Will, in that episode, Will, the new team manager, presents Nate with his very own soccer jersey. With the team. He doesn't have a jersey up till now. And on the back, where your name goes, it says Wonder Kid, because that's what social media has been calling him. And after that, Nate goes to Will and says, if you ever do anything to humiliate me again, I will make your life a fucking misery. But Nate's intentions were not to humiliate Nate. It was to congratulate him on now being this hashtag in social media. I still think of that as a tic-tac-toe sign. is this another place that Nate goes wrong? The interaction with his dad, where we see it most clearly in that episode. In the next episode, Nate is arguing during a game. He gets a yellow card for being too loud and insulting the refs. Episode 2-9 is Beard After Hours, which doesn't feature anyone but Beard. I just put it up there because one day I want to discuss that episode. And then we get to episode 10 in season 2. And Lasso says, talking about his dad, he was a good dad, and I don't think he knew that. I think if he would have known how good he really was, I don't think he would have done that. What he's talking about is Lasso's dad has committed suicide, and Lasso is finally talking about it. But the question is, for those of you who have seen the movie, has Lasso done a good enough job of telling Nate how good he is? Has Lasso done a good enough job of recognizing Nate's skills and gifts and bringing them to the forefront? I say yes. There is never a time in the show that Lasso or Roy takes credit for Nate's decisions, Nate's good plays, Nate's strategy. No one on the team does that. But we're going to see in just a minute that that's how Nate interprets a lot of their actions. Rupert, Rebecca's ex-husband, we see in episode 10 having a little whisper conversation with Nate, which is the third question of where does Nate go wrong? Is it because he suddenly becomes friends with Rupert? Because we'll find at the end of, well, I won't get that part away just yet. The second to last episode of the season, episode 11, Nate wants to run the false nine. That's a play that I don't understand in soccer talk. Lasso keeps calling it the fake nine because he's American. And Nate blows up because Ted says, yeah, we'll do it. And he says, oh, great, we'll give Ted another idea he takes all the credit for, which he never does. And Beard replies by saying this, you know, we used to believe that trees competed for light. Suzanne Cimarron's field work changed that perception. And we now realize that the forest is a socialist community and the trees work in harmony to share the sunlight. We all get the symbolism there, right? Beard's trying to say we're all a team and Nate is too worried. I don't understand. This is another part I understand. Why is Nate so darn worried about Ted Lasso getting all the credit when Lasso himself is not taking the credit?
His power and stance is fragile.
So fragile.
Mm-hmm. Or it's behavior and not confidence. In other words, he knows how to, the coach forced him to say those words, mm-hmm. but he didn't realize it was the observations and the advice that were of value. He just took from that, if you act like it, that's what's more important. He never really understood that what he thought and what he observed was the real value. So he took on all those other, you know, built up all those behaviors, mm-hmm. but forgot that it was the real behind it all was his ability to be good at what he should be doing.
I've heard this is a pattern with, like in domestic violence cases, is that, you know, the person being abused goes back to the abuser because it's all they know. And when someone treats them decently, they don't know how to react. And you can see his dad just puts him down and, you know, nothing he does is ever good enough. And he just doesn't know how to handle Ted being a good leader and a good mentor.
I feel that's right, yeah. He's a complicated one. And you don't know whether to feel sorry for him or to kind of be annoyed with him by this point. Damon named this class the holy humor of Ted humor of Ted Lasso. It's just not a lot of humor when you really talk about it on these levels. It's some real difficult stuff to consider and think about. Nate gets so courageous or foolish, depending on, he kisses Keely in episode 11. It doesn't go anywhere. She tells Roy they're fine. And then Grimm, who is the newspaper reporter that we see off and on throughout the first two seasons, and has his own following online. He is one of the most beloved characters. If you read the blogs and the ideas online, there's like a little Ted Grimm, Trent Grimm fan club. He's got his own line of clothing now. So if that's something you're interested in, I invite you to look it up. Grimm releases the news story that Lasso left the game because he had a panic attack. But then Grimm tells Lasso that it was Nate who leaked the story that he had a panic attack. Which, as viewers, we're like, why would they do that? Why would he give Lasso such a bad rap after the first season Rebecca tries it and gets shut down and forgiven? And Nate's watching all that. So why would Nate try the same thing? Again, Lasso praises Nate with a false knight. And Lasso doesn't understand why Roy... Oh, doesn't want to kill him after he confesses to kissing Keely. Here's the real arch, the top of the arch of Nate's turning point with Lasso toward the end of the last episode.
Yes, Ted, everything is okay.
What is it? What'd I do? What are you talking about? Oh, come on, man. You're mad as hell. I just want to know why. What do I have to learn here?
You want to know what you did?
Yeah, please.
Okay. I'll tell you what you did. You made me feel like I was the most important person in the whole world. And then you abandoned me. Let you switch it online just like that. And I worked my ass off trying to get your attention back, to prove myself to you, to make you like me again. But the more I did, the less you cared. It's like I was fucking invisible. I haven't even got the photo I gave you for Christmas up anymore. I think it's a picture of dumb Americans. And now you're going to play Nate's false knight when the team fuck up, which they will. You can blame it on me. Well, no, fuck that. Everybody loves you. The great Ted Lasso, I think you're a fucking joke. That would mean you wouldn't want a single match and you want to shit draft back to Canada so you fucking belong with your son. You sure as hell don't belong here. But I do. I belong here. This didn't just fall into my lap, right? I earned this. If I didn't tell you how important you were to me enough, I'm sorry about that. No, no, you know, you're full of shit. So fuck you, Ted. Richmond Downs.
So those of you who have seen it, does Nate change? Does Lasso change the way he treats Nate throughout season two? He's still praising him the whole time. What brings that on from Nate? What causes him to call Lasso a joke, telling him he should go home?
I think there's an element of jealousy there because he says, oh, everybody loves you, implying, you know, I'm trying so hard and I just don't feel like the team cares about me or nobody really values me.
And yet over and over, the team cares about him. They've given him the new jersey. They've praised him to the press. They've endorsed his social media hashtag. I don't know why Nate perceives it this way. Yes, Sharon.
I'm going to stick my neck out a little bit.
Go ahead, go. Yes.
I don't think he's really angry because the coach is supposed to make him feel good. He hasn't found a way to accept himself. And when the coach doesn't say all the things he should, which obviously we all agree he has been saying, he hasn't found it within himself yet to say, I'm okay. He's depending on somebody else to do it. And when they don't do enough of it, he's gotten so fed up with it, he can't cope with what's going on. And they all think they're doing a service, not really a favor, but they're finding what's good in him, and he hasn't accepted it yet.
I think that's right on. Because at the end of season two, here's the biggest spoiler of season two. Are you ready for it, those of you who haven't seen it? At the end of season two, we find out that Rupert has recruited Nate away from Richmond, and now Nate is the head coach of Manchester, which is Richmond's rivals. And so that begs the question, does he start getting from Rupert what he's not getting from Nate, or what he perceives he's not getting from Nate, but is still not what he really needs?
A false god.
Oh, excellent.
I'll just throw that out.
Way to make it biblical. I appreciate that.
I also think in a lot of ways it's about power, and like for someone who has never had any power or authority, you know, once you get a little taste of that, you just want more. And it seems like that's what is happening with Nate, because he keeps blaming things on Ted because he needs to get to a higher place of power. And, you know, how do you do that but by stepping on other people and knocking them back down so that you can take their spot?
I would agree with that. And I also feel like it's a little bit like it's never enough,
yeah,
right? And so once you start to have that attention or start to have a little power, you perceive that you need and want more.
Do we all know people like that in our lives?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, great. You don't have to say their names. Mm-hmm. Yes, I have an aunt like that.
Well, I think there are many, I mean, psychological studies that have been done about kind of the effects of bullying and the effects of, you know, how often children are mistreated and then they become their abuser as an adult, you know, just as a cycle. And I feel like that's what we're seeing in here a little bit.
Why can't Nate turn it around? Jimmy Tark does.
Because he's never had any self-confidence or security within himself.
That's what puzzles me, is that all these other characters have these other flaws or deficiencies or inadequate, and they all over and over. I think that's why I keep watching. They find ways to overcome it. They find ways to reinvent themselves and recreate themselves into new people. And Nate, that's just the opposite. I'm really troubled by him, to be honest with you.
But maybe that is central to season three. That he comes around.
I think you're right. But I don't want to wait.
But I think that's also part of what makes this show so great, because that's life. I mean, there's always going to be that one person that can't turn it around and can't do the right thing, no matter how many opportunities they're given to do that, because we're human, you know. And I wouldn't like the show as much if everybody turned into a happy ending.
That's true.
I hate that I just said that out loud to you.
I know, I feel really bad about that.
I don't have affinity to happy endings.
Terrible.
But, I mean, like, it's really, you know, I mean, it makes it more real. It makes it more approachable, because we've all dealt with that person. You know, we've all had encounters with a person who just, no matter what opportunities you give them, they can't take the high road, or, you know.
And if you're leading a team of people, whether it's a small business or an academic department or a volunteer organization, if those people keep being allowed to poison the well of what you're trying to accomplish, you can only try so hard, and at some point you have to have them find a different team to play on. Or it just continually erodes the morale and the goals and the focus of what you're trying to accomplish.
And I would say it depends on who you choose as your role model. Mm-hmm. You can choose Nate, who he chose, who Jamie chose. And I see that in your personal life too, as to who's the role models that you pattern your behaviors after. And you don't always choose the right ways.
Can I make one quick lane change here? I do think it's really, you were playing the video clip about Nate and his dad. There are not very many strong or positive father figures associated with the show. I was just trying to think of, are there any? And I think Higgins is like the only one. Mm-hmm. But there are lots of kind
Ted's of... a good dad, though.
Yeah.
But he's, because of circumstance, he's distant.
Yeah, right.
So, but yeah, that's a good point. I think fathers in general have a bad rap in media.
Great. Well, good fathers don't make nearly as great stories as your co-hosts.
When you made that comparison, Jamie, you know, he turned himself around. In the issue, Jamie had his moments in the sun and, you know, had that false, it was a false confidence, but he had that, you know, the adulation of the crowd and all that. And, you know, realized it wasn't what he needed, maybe. And Nate didn't have that. Or was just beginning to have it.
I think you're right. And I'm really eager to come back after season three and have this talk again. See what happens. I want to.
We're planning on that.
Yeah, we're doing it, aren't
we? Oh, it sounds like we just made the
decision. It's not my decision. I know. It's great, but
we can pass this along to
I want to leave you because this has been such a fun journey for me to go through this. Okay. Oh, no, go away. I want to leave you with this clip. And I want to give you, if you will, accept an unconventional prayer for me for the end of our time together. I want to show this clip if you haven't seen it. This is the beginning of the Little Green Army Men in the story. And so I would like to show this, and I'll be giving you all Little Green Army people as a gratitude and a prayer and a thank you for the time that we've spent together. And I hope that we can gather back again and continue to have meaningful conversation. So if you haven't seen it, or if you have, it's so worth watching over and over and over again. Here we go.
Hey, Art, I'll make sure you're doing okay. You're up next.
I expect nothing less from you. So did you need something to post that? Because that doesn't sound good.
It's not wrong. It's a pair of bags for my little boy. Huh. There's something in here to help cheer you up. Yeah. Got a small battalion of arms. I need to appear in the car that I'm supposed to set them up in my apartment. I'll see you in a second. Oh. I'm waiting for Zoom. Oh, I got one of them. Hey. You know, this right here is some of the best barbecue sauce in Kansas City. Which makes some of the best barbecue sauce in the world. Oh, yes. You got some kind of food or something that just teleports right back home if you don't want to cook.
Will that be all you say?
No, actually, you know, the whole reason I'm here is because I have a little trouble figuring out Jamie Tarr's operating instructions. I'm just seeing if you haven't had any advice.
No, sorry, I'm afraid.
Ooh. Your eyes just lit up. You got an idea. What is it?
I was just going to say you should go and talk to Kay. I mean, you two have an office rapport. If anyone knows Jamie, it's her.
That's why you're the boss, right? That's good. Hey, say well. Give one of these things. See, we'll let you a good one. Okay, this right here will be your first line of defense. Is that little turkey turning lounge come back. How about that? We'll aim them right at the door there for you. All right, thanks, boss. I appreciate it.
And so throughout the series, we see Ted giving away his little Green Army men to those that he comes to call friends and family. So enjoy your little Green Army people. That is my thank you and my prayer with you and for you. And Grant, you get to close us.
Awesome. Yes, I have it all written down. Thank you, Google. We appreciate it. Thanks again for joining us this morning. And next week, just a little preview of what's to come. The First Presbyterian Church's scholar in residence, Dr. Dan Deffenbaugh, will be joining us 9:15 to 10:15, discussing universal salvation. So he's always a tremendous Sunday Forum guest. So with that, we'll close in prayer, and we'll go about our worship service. So, Lord, thank you for our time together, our conversation, and the space in which we have it. Help us to have a great rest of our day and celebrate First Presbyterian Church's partnership with Hastings College. In the name we pray. Amen. Thanks, y'all.
Thank you.